an evil in someone's heart and a weapon of mass destruction in their hands. We know we need gun control. We also need to fight against hate in all of its forms to truly build a multiracial democracy, the one that we all want so desperately. Racism, anti-Semitism, xenophobia, Islamophobia, homophobia, and hate in all forms are choking at the promise of our democracy and regressing us into tribalism. We are so much better than that. In Congress, we must treat both the issue of gun control and the root causes of hate. The Great Replacement Theory believes that only white people are responsible for progress in our society, and that the growth of a multiracial and multireligious society is a threat to white people's existence and the health of our nation. This has spread and infected the minds of so many. It is a conspiracy theory used to stoke racially motivated violence all around the world, from Charlottesville to Christchurch, New Zealand, and recently Buffalo, New York, where a white supremacist wrote a 180-page manifesto citing this conspiracy and then drove more than 200 miles where he carried out a mass shooting. In New York, not in the South, in New York State. These are no longer fringe elements of our society. The Great Replacement Theory has gone mainstream thanks to right-wing Republican pundits like Tucker Carlson, who mentioned these theories more than 400 times on the most watched news network in the country. Top Republican leaders use it as a political weapon. It now threatens our very existence as a democracy and as a society. Our lives and our sense of safety are threatened. Nazi thinking, veiled as political banter, can no longer go unrecognized and condemned by our nation's legislative body and by the Democratic Party. Our response must be strong, and we must demand accountability. This is why I'm introducing a resolution condemning the Great Replacement Theory. We need every member of Congress, Democrats and Republicans alike, on the record condemning this dangerous theory. I want to know how Minority Leader Kevin McCarthy voted, Representative Stefanik and others. Are they willing to truly stand up to hatred and evil, or are they going to stand with it? Everyone will be on the record. It's time for accountability and transparency on this issue. I am grateful and so humbled. To my co-leads whose partnership demonstrates the broad recognition by Democrats that we cannot be silent in the face of hateful rhetoric that is racist, anti-Semitic, xenophobic, Islamophobic, and nativist. Our co-leads include Congressional Black Caucus Chairwoman Beatty, Congressional Hispanic Caucus Chairman Ruiz, Congressional Asian Pacific American Caucus Chairwoman Chu, LGBTQ Plus Equality Caucus Chairman Cicilline, Congressional Progressive Caucus Chair Jayapal, Congressman Takano, Congressman Raskin, and Buffalo's very own Congressman Higgins, who I want to thank personally. I called Congressman Higgins right after this massacre occurred, and he gave me the support and the green light to move forward with writing this resolution. So I want to thank him personally. I also want to remember the victims who tragically died in Buffalo. Aaron Salter, Ruth Whitfield, Pearly Young, Catherine Cat Massey, Heward Patterson, Celestine Cheney, Roberta Drury, Margus D. Morrison, Andre McNeil, and Geraldine Talley. These people should be with us today. Many of them were seniors. All they wanted to do was go shopping and pick up goods for their homes. Someone was there to pick up a birthday cake for their three-year-old child, living their lives peacefully, law-abiding citizens. This person staked out this area before committing this heinous massacre. We are grateful also for the survivors, some of which are here with us today. Well, the families of them are here. But the survivors are Zaire Goodman, Jennifer Warrington, and Christopher Braden. I also want to acknowledge Zanetta Everhart, whose son Zaire survived to the Buffalo shooting. Zanetta, can you please just... And you'll hear from her later. She is here with us today as well to say a few words. I also want to acknowledge a few organizations who are joining us today in support of this resolution. Thank you to the American Federation of Teachers, J Street, the National Urban League, the Council on American Islamic Relations, and the National Education Association. This is a clear example of Congress and the country coming together across race, across class, across age, across ideological differences, coming together to condemn this hateful theory that is destroying our country. It is now my honor, and I just want to thank Speaker Pelosi so much for her continued mentorship and guidance and support, and Leader Hoyer as well for allowing us to come to the floor for a vote. I will now turn it over to Speaker Pelosi, who joins us in support of our efforts to condemn the Great Replacement Theory. Speaker Pelosi and Leader Hoyer were critical in helping us get this resolution to the floor, and I'm honored to have them today.
Thank you very much, Congressman Bowman, for the opportunity to speak with you on this subject today, for your tremendous leadership, your commitment, which on this subject and many others, which I have seen demonstrated in your district and in the halls of Congress. What is happening with this great replacement conspiracy theory is harmful to our country. It endangers our people. It weakens our country and is a threat to our democracy. So thank you for your tremendous leadership in making this day possible when we will pass this on the floor. Thank you, Mr. Hoyer, for making it possible so soon. This is a call to racist violence on their part. So two things I want to say. And again, I'm honored to be with all of the parties here, our caucuses, families of victims of violence and the rest, as well as our colleagues with important legislation. The combination of this replacement theory advocacy and gun violence is poisonous. It's explosive, and we have seen it take lives. But it is not new to our country, and this is what I want to read, because we're going to be hearing from so many members and guests testifying here. This is what happened in a previous century. A nativist party that peaked in the 1850s, filling the vacuum left by Henry Clay's death and the collapse of the Whig Party, viewed German and Irish immigrants as a threat to their vision of an Anglo-Saxon Protestant nation. As they espoused extreme anti-immigrant and anti-Catholic rhetoric, calling for restrictions on immigration, exclusion of foreign-born voters, barring Catholics from holding office, and imposing a 21-year residency requirement for citizenship. The Know-Nothings racist legacy has lingered. It's down there. From the targeting of Asian immigrants in the late 19th century to hateful anti-immigrant rhetoric today. So this sentiment, this insecurity on the part of some people to take it out on others. Last night I had the privilege of speaking to the Reagan Institute for opening their office here, their institute here, and I said, I'm going to quote a Republican president. President Reagan spoke out about the importance of immigration to our country. This is the last speech I will make as President of the United States, he said, and I want to communicate a message to the country I love. He talked about the Statue of Liberty and the beacon of hope that it was to the world. He then talked about America's preeminence in the world depended on the constant flow of newcomers to our country. And once we close the door to that, he said, we will cease being preeminent in the world. Ronald Reagan, and he was a champion for immigration. So this is partially immigration. It's other fears that they have of women, LGBTQ, African-American community, newcomers to our country, people who don't look like them. But in their advocacy, they are undermining the possible further greatness of America. Whether we're talking about science that benefits from diversity, whether we're talking about education in our schools where our children benefit from that diversity, it is most unfortunate that their insecurities stand in their way of being really, truly American, because America is enhanced by the optimism, the hope, the determination, the courage of all people in our society to rise up. This is ridiculous, this replacement theory, and I commend Congressman Bowman for his leadership, his impatience with it all, his bringing it to the floor as soon as possible. And I hope that people in our country, people of faith, people of patriotism, people of love for our children and their future, will join him in rejecting and condemning this dangerous, dangerous theory. And with that, I'm very pleased to yield to the distinguished majority leader who's bringing this legislation to the floor and a champion on these issues in our country and globally, Steny Hoyer.
Thank you very much, Madam Speaker. Too many days of violence and grief. Too many days. We grieve with you, family. We grieve with your loss of your loved ones. Whatever relationship that was, it was a relationship you counted on. Too many days of violence and grief. I want to thank Representative Bowman for his leadership in so quickly acting to confront this hate and bigotry, which for far too long, as the Speaker said, has been with us, and he said as well. Throughout history, we've seen twisted ideologies concocted to justify violence and exclusion against Black and Latino people, against Jewish people, against Asian people, against LGBT people, and people who are somehow different. Brian Stevenson has a museum in Montgomery, Alabama. And he says the first thing you need to do to mistreat people is to make them less than people. Not worthy of that admonition that we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men, and certainly in the 19th century, they would have said, all people are created equal and endowed by God with certain unalienable rights. And that is to life, to life, to life. The kind of belief, however, fails to understand that America does not belong to one group or another. It's a nation. These microphones make it tough to read this stuff, doesn't it? I noticed you had that problem too. It's a nation where all who love freedom, democracy, and the rule of law can find a home. That's the criteria. Being a good citizen. Build a better future for themselves and their families. Our nation's motto is, as the Speaker so often intones, E Pluribus Unum. To that extent, it's sort of like a marriage where two people become one. Well, our founders said that the people who come here become one. One nation. Under God. We all come from different backgrounds. My father was born in Denmark, in Copenhagen. Many of you behind me and in front of me have parents or yourselves come from other lands. That's what America is about. The so-called Great Replacement Theory is just the latest version, Nancy, as you said, just the latest version of the old idea that America does not belong to all Americans, and that it's not all Americans belong to our country. Spread online, and that's one of the problems. Hate is so easy to spread today, and so quickly spread, and so insightful, which is what happened in Buffalo. Mr. Higgins was on the floor just this morning speaking about that hate. So I'm pleased to join you, knowing full well that this is not new. When the Irish came to Boston, they were the others. When the Italians came to Providence, they were the others. When the Jews came to New York, they were the others. African Americans were here, and they were the others. It is time, as these signs say, to stop hate. That's what this resolution is about. Congressman, thank you so much for bringing it to the floor in such a timely fashion. I was honored to be able to facilitate its voting this day by the Congress of the United States of America, saying no to hate. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Leader. I would now like to bring up the chairwoman of the Congressional Black Caucus, Chairwoman Beatty. But before I do, I just want to thank her for her leadership and mentorship throughout my time in Congress. I'm a freshman, and I've learned so much from her. And she was one of the first calls I made as we started to draft this resolution, and she supported us from the very beginning. Chairwoman Beatty.
Thank you so much to my colleague, my friend, Jamaal Bowman, for doing an outstanding job of speaking truth to power. I'm going to be brief, but I think it's important for you to understand what you are witnessing here as we fight against this conspiracy replacement theory. We stand here united. We stand here representing our diversity because we understand that that diversity is our strength. But we are united, and that is our power. We come to you as our caucus in Congress with the country standing with us. We know what we have witnessed over the past days, months, and I'm almost embarrassed to say years. And to the family members who are here, there are not enough words that we can offer you. We pray, we stand up, we join latched and locked in arms with our regret, with our heartfelt love. But that's not enough. And I want to be the first to say to you, we understand that that is not enough. So we stand here today speaking not to these families and not to these Democrat members and others who join with us, but we speak to America. We cannot do this alone. You need to understand that this is bigger than any piece of legislation that we can legislate. This message is about making sure that you understand that there are consequences to elections. And what we are seeing today, the consequences of when we don't stand up as a people. Like these families, I'm tired of coming here before media and thinking that this is a great job, because it is not. But the only hope we have is we have a resolution that will come to this floor with hundreds of signatures on it, asking you, you as media, to help us and be on the country's side. Get the stories right. Let America know that we're watching you and we are no longer afraid to stand up, to speak out, too many Americans, too many little babies, innocent babies who lost their lives. What do you say, America? So I say to you, as chair of the Congressional Black Caucus, a proud partner with the Tri-Caucus and others who are gathered here, join with us for country, for caucus, for families and the people. Thank you.
You know, Chair Beatty is not the only mentor I've had since I've been in Congress. Chairwoman Jayapal of the CPC has also been a tremendous mentor ever since winning my primary. I call her constantly. She calls me right back. And she supported this work from the very beginning. And I just want to continue to echo the word unity that's here today. The CBC, the CPC, the Tri-Caucus, we are here united against evil, hate, the great replacement theory, and white supremacy. Chair Jayapal.
Thank you so much, Congressman Bowman. You have been such a champion on so many issues, but the speed with which you responded to this and the necessary work that you've done to put this resolution together and to bring together the co-sponsors and to bring to us, as once again, for us to look into your faces, the families who have been affected by this violence, and say to you that we understand what our role is, and we understand that we have a lot more work to do to be able to move this country forward. We are here because words used by people in power matter. They don't solve the problem, but they matter. We are here to call out one of the most pernicious, pervasive, and dangerous forces in our country, the Great Replacement Theory. This racist, anti-Semitic conspiracy theory animated the gunman who stole 10 precious lives last month in Buffalo. It radicalized the gunman responsible for the tragedies in El Paso, the Tree of Life Synagogue, Mother Emanuel AME Church, and so many more. It has stolen Black, Jewish, Latino, Muslim, and immigrant lives. But while white supremacy and racial hatred may be resurging, they are not new. The seeds of the Buffalo shooting were planted beneath the trees that held the thousands of lynching victims throughout our country's history. The Great Replacement Theory belongs to the same tradition as the bombings of Philadelphia and Tulsa, as racist police violence, and as decades of racist policy that have been used to deny Black Americans their full civil and human rights and demonize immigrants and people of color. I have seen up close the consequences that follow when we normalize stereotyping and the blaming of certain ethnic and racial groups. I got my start in organizing over 25 years ago, organizing after 9/11. It was an era that was defined by terror for Arab and Muslim, South Asian, Middle Eastern, and Sikh people. And in the wake of 9/11, we looked to the lessons of the Black Civil Rights Movement and its leaders for guidance in how to fight back. And we came together across different backgrounds to stand up for justice. And that is what we must continue to do, because it is so very clear that our rights and our destinies are intertwined, and that every one of these racist white supremacist theories that has been used from the beginning of our country, directed at different groups of people each time, is based on fear. It is based on pushing forward a myth that one group is hurting when another group succeeds. It is based on turning us against us. But there is another way. To govern not from fear, but from love. To recognize that even as some would try to divide us, we insist that we are stronger together. That we call out the white supremacy and racism and otherizing when we see it here in Congress and in our communities. And we support the many communities across the country who are feeling the pain of discrimination and anger and violence towards them, and fear for their own lives of being gunned down in a supermarket or in a movie theater. And at the same time, while we do this calling out, what we are asking America with this press conference and with this resolution is to be called in. Let us call you in, white, black, brown, indigenous, into this movement to explain that the myths that are being perpetuated and put forward are not accurate, and that we have a different vision of love over fear and of unity over separation. And that's why I'm so proud to be here as a co-lead, as a supporter, as chair of the almost 100-member strong Congressional Progressive Caucus. We have a lot of work to do to fight this racist and anti-Semitic ideology and to live up to our American values for justice for all. But the way we start is by doing what we are doing here, coming together, calling out what is wrong, and calling in Americans across this country to reject this great replacement theory and to stand together for justice. Okay, and let me turn it over now to my colleague from New York, Representative Adriano Espaillat.
Thank you, Chairwoman Jayapal. Thank you, Congressman Bowman, for your leadership in bringing this forward. You know, the great Eleanor Roosevelt went to speak before the Daughters of the American Revolution. And we knew that, we know that that organization has a very xenophobic past. And they were dressed in their Sunday best as they went to hear the First Lady speak. And she began by addressing them as my fellow immigrants. And of course, the room was in shock. But the truth of the matter is that unless you're a Native American or unless you were brought here in chains, you did not originate from this land. And the names just pop at us and we don't even question them. Los Angeles, Arizona, La Florida, Colorado. These names were not made up. They are part of the history of our nation. And yet, we have not too far from here, in Charlottesville, a group of torch-bearing white supremacists simulating Nazi Germany, spewing this lie, the great replacement lie. And a lie told 1,000 times, to me, is still a lie. And so it shows up in Buffalo. And it shows up in Texas. And it shows up everywhere and anywhere where people have the courage to be different and to be diverse. The strength of our nation, the spinal cord of our nation, that's what makes us walk straight and with determination, our diversity. So we will push back against this lie. Everywhere it shows its ugly head, whether it is in Buffalo or in Uvalde, Texas, or right across the Potomac right here in Virginia, almost walking distance from the U.S. Capitol. So we must come together as a country. We must come together and recognize that a lie told 1,000 lies times is still a lie. And that we must come together and be courageous for the most important factor of our country, diversity. I came here as an immigrant. I didn't really know anybody from any other country. I didn't know the Irish. I didn't know the Jewish community. I didn't know the Greek community. I didn't know the great migration from the south of African Americans. I was just a Caribbean boy that came here with a luggage full of dreams. But this nation, its diversity, made me a stronger person. And maybe that's why I'm here in the U.S. Congress right now. So, Congressman, thank you for your leadership. We must all bond together and defeat this lie. God bless you.
Thank you so much, Rep. Espaillat. It's my honor to now bring up the KPAC chair, Chairwoman Judy Chu, and again, another person where when I call on her, when our office calls on her, she's there to support, and I thank her so much for being an original co-lead of this resolution. Judy Chu.
Today, we are uniting to condemn not only the recent attack in Buffalo, but attacks fueled by white supremacy that have become regular occurrences in our country. And we are here to condemn great replacement theory. I'm Congressmember Judy Chu, Chair of the Congressional Asian Pacific American Caucus, or KPAC, and I stand together with our Tri-Caucus and all our Democratic members of Congress in standing up and speaking out against this harmful theory. And I want to thank Congressman Bowman for your leadership in bringing us together and putting forth this resolution so quickly, as well as our KPAC Second Vice Chair, Congressman Mark Takano, for his insistence that we take action on this. When I first heard the news about a young hate-filled male driving 200 miles to kill black people at a supermarket, ultimately killing 10, I was absolutely horrified. But I had a flashback. I had a flashback to a year earlier when in Atlanta, a young hate-filled male drove to an Asian spa with the intent of killing Asian women. And he shot into that spa, then drove 27 miles more to two more spas so he could kill more Asian women. And that day, he killed 8 people, 6 of them Asian women. We visited the families soon thereafter, and I will never forget the tears and sobs that were coming out of them as they realized that they lost their mother, their grandmother, their wives forever. Each time another violent attack is carried out against communities of color, we're given the excuse of the killer's mental illness, family dynamics, and even video games they may have played. But I am here to tell you today that many of these attacks stem from white supremacists who've been given a platform and a voice to fuel this hatred with great replacement theory. The time is well past to extinguish the flames of hatred and baseless conspiracies that are destroying lives. It's our responsibility in Congress to publicly condemn these racist theories in all their forms. And that's why today the House is going to pass Representative Bowman's resolution condemning the great replacement theory, and we will reaffirm our commitment to fighting hatred and injustice. So as we continue to grieve the loss of those in Buffalo, and as those families work toward healing, we have a renewed commitment to end this epidemic of senseless violence fueled by white supremacy. Enough is enough. And now I'd like to bring up, in fact, somebody who feels very passionate about this issue and has really pushed it, Representative Mark Takano.
Thank you. Thank you, Congresswoman Chu. Thank you, Representative Bowman, for your leadership. Congressman Higgins, I'm going to get through this as quick as I can because you're the congressman whose district suffered this terrible tragedy of the families that are standing behind you. Look, we all have an experience, and we know by common sense the difference between the sacred and the taboo. We know that motherhood is sacred. We know that certain kinds of friendships are sacred. Certain relationships are sacred. We know, but we also know what is taboo. We know that racism should be taboo. And if a racist thought enters our minds, it should be shooed away as a fit of madness, a fit of anger, and that we would get rid of that fleeting moment, that fleeting emotion. We know that anti-Semitism should be taboo, that anybody in the political and public sphere, when we hear an anti-Semitic sentiment, we should not give it any space, let alone any airtime on a network. And it should be roundly condemned by responsible leaders. Replacement theory. should be taboo. And it must be, but unfortunately it is not. As mentioned by my friend Representative Bowman, it has been mentioned hundreds of times by somebody who has the highest rated television show on one of the biggest audience drawing networks. And therefore you see Republican leaders in our Congress, from the top leadership down to the rank and file, whose tongues have been swallowed. They cannot condemn what should be called taboo. So I'm here with you today to pass a resolution in Congress from the highest lawmaking body in our country to say that the replacement theory should be condemned, is condemned, and should be taboo. But more than that, I want you, the media, and everyone out in America to call upon fellow Americans to not let this be normalized, to not allow this theory to any credence in the public sphere. E pluribus unum is sacred. The great replacement theory should and must be taboo in the United States of America.
Thank you so much. It is now my honor to introduce Representative Higgins, who represents Buffalo, New York.
Thank you very much, Jamaal. Let me, the hour is getting late. We have votes. We also have Jamie Raskin here with us, and pleased to have him. Jamie was on the floor 15 minutes ago talking about this very issue and the issue of hate. I want to bring up Zanetta Everhart, Dominique Douglas, Pam Young, and Michelle Spike, because this is really why we're here. Let's do something constructive here today and stop calling this the great replacement theory. It's not great. It's evil. It's born out of ignorance. We need to call this the great renewal therapy. When tragedies like this get the nation's attention about what needs to happen right here under this man's leadership as it relates to calling out hate, white supremacy, and racism. That's what this is. If these creeps that refer to this theory, which isn't a theory, or at least to be credible, it's a theory that has to be proven. And the opposite is true in America, and I'll tell you why. If it were true, this whole area would be empty. None of you would be here. Including me, whether it was the 1850s with the Know Nothing Party, they just weren't in Boston. They were in Buffalo and Baton Rouge and everywhere else. They hated the outsiders. They hated Catholics. They hated Jews. They hated the Irish. They hated the Italians. They hated anybody that was different. Anybody that was different. It was used again in the 1928 presidential campaign when the first major party nominated an Irish Catholic. His ethnicity and his religion was used against him. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all of us, men and women, are created equal and are endowed by our Creator with certain unalienable rights. Among them is life, liberty, and not the promise of happiness, but the unfettered pursuit of it. But more importantly, what wasn't included in those words, if those words don't mean everybody, they mean nothing to anybody. Zanetta Everhart, she's been here for 2 days. She's a friend. She's the chief inclusion and diversity officer for my friend, State Senator Tim Kennedy from New York. As I said before, Zanetta's stories and all of these stories, they have a tragic dimension to it. But there's also a magic to it as well. Because as I said before, it's said that we suffer our way to wisdom. To live is to suffer, to endure the suffering is to give meaning to the suffering. The only way that we honor those who are affected the most is by doing the right thing right behind us. Zanetta Everhart.
Thank you, Congressman Higgins. I'm going to be very quick because I am from Buffalo, and this heat is insane, okay? my son So my son, Zaire Goodman, as you all know, I'm sure, was injured in the Tops shooting. He was an employee at Tops. And I've done a lot of interviews over the last couple of weeks, a lot. And the one thing people keep asking me is, how do you remain so strong? How do you remain so strong throughout all of this? And what I tell people is that I am drawing my strength from Zaire. The day that he was shot, and when I was finally allowed into the hospital room to see him, the first thing he said to me was, I knew you'd be a mess, Mom, but I knew I'd be fine. With a hole in his neck and his back, he knew he'd be fine. And yes, I was a mess. And so I stand here before you as a fixer. The great replacement theory, there's a very easy fix for this. And it's one of the other things that I've been saying throughout this process. Education. If we are telling the truth about what the colonizers did in this country from the very beginning, we would not have the great replacement theory. It wouldn't be a thing. We have to tell the truth about slavery and what this country did to my ancestors. And that's all I have to say.
Congressman Jamie Raskin.
Thank you, Congressman Higgins. And Zanetta, thank you for your powerful remarks. And thanks for commenting on the weather. I like to say that on Capitol Hill, it's not the heat, it's the stupidity. So the resolution that you've offered, Congressman Bowman, is some enlightenment for us. And I want to thank you for doing it. The replacement theory unifies racism, anti-Semitism, and conspiracy theory into a toxic brew. And the people of Buffalo suffered a terrible massacre because an 18-year-old with an AR-15 jacked up on the replacement theory decided to go and to take the law into his own hands and destroy multiple lives on that day. So he was taught by somebody online and or elsewhere the replacement theory, but he wasn't taught about what's really great about America, which has been the struggle to make real the ideals of the Declaration of Independence that Congressman Higgins quoted to you. Government by the governed, the unalienable rights of the people, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, all of us being created equal. It's been the struggle to make those reals that are the real creed of America. We are not defined by virtue of being one race. We are not defined by virtue of being one religion. We are not defined by virtue of being one ethnicity. We are defined by one constitution and the rule of law under it. And this racist, anti-Semitic, fanatical theory has been mobilized by the dangerous extremists of America to pump people up on gun violence. And so I'm proud that we are voting to condemn the replacement theory. I hope that every member of Congress will vote to condemn the white replacement theory. If you can condemn critical legal studies, if you can condemn critical legal studies, which has not resulted in the death of anyone in America, you can condemn great white replacement theory, which is now being invoked in massacres around the country. So I want to thank Congressman Bowman for his leadership. Of course, because of the First Amendment, you've got a right to utter whatever absurdities and fanaticisms you want, which is why we need to control the gun violence and we need to pass the gun violence legislation that's on the floor today. Thank you.
Dominique Douglas.
Hi, everyone. I'll keep this super brief. Margus Morrison, the first one killed, was my cousin. He was also father to six, and a son and a brother. And unfortunately, his mother and his daughter buried him on their birthdays. This is not a hate versus fighting hate with hate. And this isn't us against anyone. This is Americans. We are black Americans. We expect to be protected like all other Americans should be protected. But we need help. So sitting around and talking is one thing, but we need to pass this legislation. We need to support, and I'm so happy for your support. We all are, but we need more. So I ask everyone else, support us. Support your fellow Americans. Because black Americans are being attacked, which means the democracy of all of you is being attacked. If you think it stops with us, please believe it won't. We're on the top chopping block right now, but it will be, they come after everyone. Help us. Help us help you. We are all American. We just expect the support of our other Americans to help black Americans right now.
Yes. Thank you, Dominique. Pam Young.
Hi, everyone. My name is Pam Young. My mother was Pearl Young, who was massacred, murdered, and killed on May 14th. I use those words. I don't say died because she didn't die regularly. She was killed by a angry person believing the replacement theory. But I'm also going to say that that very same day, I called my very best friend. I'm saying this to Congress. My very best friend who I called, her name's Mary Ann. Mary Ann is a Republican, a straight up Republican, y'all. But guess what? She was empathetic toward me. She held me when I needed to be held. And you know something I tell you guys today? Every single one of us have one thing in common. We cry the same tears. When your tears come down and my tears come down, if we put them in a bottle, they'd all be clear. They're not black or white, Republican or Democrat. They're the same tears, and we need to get that out to people. I got one more thing to say, and then I'm going to sit down. Listen to me. I sound like I'm preaching, y'all, to Senator Kennedy and Congressman Higgins and Congressman Bowman. I promise you that just like that man traveled over 200 miles to massacre my mother and nine others, I will travel throughout throughout New York State telling them that this is not who we are. We are better than this as Americans. Those 10 people who died were the best of Americans. If you had children, you would want your children to grow up to be like them. Civil activists, teachers. Those are the ones that he murdered and shot down that day. But I promise you one thing. Every tear that I cry, because I'm going to go back to my hotel room and I'm going to cry tonight. But every tear I cry will be a fuel for action.
Before I call up, thank you so much, Pam. Before I call up Michelle Spite, I just want to take one or two quick questions from the media because unfortunately myself and Congressman Higgins have to go vote. One or two quick questions, if you, yes, sir.
There's no conflict. The issue of universal background checks could probably have avoided the incident in Buffalo, the incident in Uvalde, the incident in Sandy Hook, because they have a common denominator. Sandy Hook, the shooting started at 9:35 a.m. It was completed at 9:40 a.m. One shooter. With a weapon of mass destruction, 5 minutes, kills 26 people on the elementary school campus, including 20 kids between the ages of 5 and 7, many of whom had 3 and 4 bullet wounds in them. Buffalo. The shooting started at 2:30. It was over at 2:32.3. 2.3 seconds. 10 people dead. One shooter with a semi-automatic weapon. This is a death and destruction beyond human comprehension. Background checks have nothing to do with the Constitution. In fact, the reverse is true. We have an obligation to protect our people.
That's right. That's right.
This is not about taking people's guns. The one, you know, there's something that they call in negotiations and in compromise. It's called the GEM statement. It's something that we all agree on. Republicans in this sometimes godforsaken town, and Democrats in this town should be able to agree that of the 400 million guns in America, out of the 11 million semi-automatic weapons in America, that we should be able to reach a compromise on universal background checks. I don't get it. And I'll tell you, that is the point that we have to push. 85% of Americans support universal background checks. Let's hold their feet to the fire, because they want this issue to go away as quickly as possible.
We are 3% of the world's population. We carry 60% of the world's guns. That is unconscionable. I want to bring up Ms. Michelle Spite to share a few words. Ms. Spite.
Absolutely, and they will be few. I was one of the only ones, uniquely but not happily, who lost two members in that fatal shooting, that massacre on May 14th. I am here because with every passion in me, with every fight and every vigor, I will not stop until we take a candid look and keep the focus where it is. On May 14th, there were 10 victims who lost their lives and 3 who will never probably have the same capacity of life again. Until we put aside our differences of our political stance, be it Democrat or Republican, be it black or be it white, and focus on the matter that white supremacy is alive and well, that it needs to be called what it is, that it is not some deranged, delusional person who acted this way, but he was motivated, he was educated, and he was fed a daily appetite of hate. This is what we need to look at, America. So I challenge you all behind the camera, since you have the power, that you change your articulation and that you focus on what the focus is. It shouldn't be on to the next shooting, the next event. Let's park right where we are until we see change. And until we see those bills reformed and laws enacted, we will continue to be here. So get very familiar with our faces. Thank you.
Finally, I just want to bring up Tim Kennedy, who's been a real visionary and courageous work over the past 3 weeks in Buffalo. He's my good friend. He's my colleague in the state Senate. And
thanks, Congressman.
Zanetta's boss.
Zanetta's my boss. And I think she and other Americans are the boss of the United States Congress. And she and our fellow Americans need to have our voices heard, that the time for action is now. Every day that Congress delays is another day closer to the next mass shooting in this country. We've heard statistics after statistics. I want to recognize Zanetta Everhart, the head of diversity and inclusion in my office, and the mother of Zaire Goodman, who took a bullet through the neck and out the backside for courageously speaking before Congress today. I want to recognize these extraordinary voices behind me, the face of the families of those that weren't as lucky and blessed as Zaire to have made it through that massacre in Buffalo. And on the heels of what we're dealing with in Buffalo, our community brokenhearted, grieving, healing, picking up the pieces, and calling for action, we have an opportunity to do better as Americans. When I come to Washington, D.C., I'm inspired by what it means to stand in the Capitol, in the footsteps of the great leaders that have come before us, that have made our country the greatest nation in the history of the world. But it's only because those leaders that have come before us have listened to the public when we have faced challenges as a nation. And I believe in my heart of hearts that God has put us here in this moment. This is a moment in our nation's history that we have to take advantage of one of the worst massacres in our nation's history to do something positive about the future, to make some positive changes for the next generation. I'm inspired that Congressman Bowman and his colleagues in Congress today calling out the lie that is the great replacement theory. A sickness that has come across our land. We are better than that as Americans. Congress today is demonstrating that. In the wake of the gun violence that has taken place across our country, New York State stepped forward and put in place 10 pieces of legislation that will make our streets in New York safer. But we need Congress to act. Every state in America can take its own respective action, but we need federal action across the board that will allow safety in our streets, irrespective of what state you live in, what city you live in, what suburb or rural area of America you live in. We all deserve to live in peace and to live the American dream. And we cannot do that if Congress doesn't act. So I appreciate Congressman Bowman's leadership and our Congress taking action. But this is not enough. Our country, in this moment, in this election year, we have to hold our representatives accountable, Democrat and Republican. Take a look at your representatives' voting sheet. Take a look at how they vote on the issues that matter to you. Take a look at how they vote on the great replacement lie that's before Congress today. Take a look at how they vote on common sense gun legislation that'll reform the gun laws in America that nearly 90% of our nation's residents support and that nearly half of Congress will vote against. Mm-hmm. And hold those representatives accountable at the voting booth this November. That's what we can do as Americans. We can stand up, we can hold each other accountable, we can call out white supremacy when we see it, we can call out racism when we see it, we can call out hate when we see it, but we can call out our representatives when they vote the wrong way and allow for simple, common sense gun reform legislation to be voted down in our nation's capital. That's unacceptable, and we cannot accept that in this great United States of America. And we, with the families of the slain 10 from Buffalo, and the families of the poor souls that were lost in Uvalde, and every other community across this great nation who has lost loved ones, have to stand together, and we will continue to fight on and press on and demand more until we get the representation and the action that our country deserves. Thank you, Congressman
thank Bowman. You, thank you so much. I'll now take a few additional questions. Sorry, I had to run to go vote. I will now take a few additional questions if there are any additional questions out there. Yes, sir. Can you identify, say your name and where you're from? The bottom line for us is that the resolution passes. However it comes to the floor and however it's voted on is something that is really important for Congress to take the position of condemning the great replacement theory. That was the key for us, and we're happy that it's happening. Hi. Yes. Sure, you're not a member of the media, but yes, you are. Go ahead. Well, we're going to condemn it as Congress today, but this needs to be condemned at every state house across the country, every county across the country, and every city across the country. And we need high schools to be leaders in condemning the great replacement theory. And we need to recognize what's happening right now in our country. Think of what the previous president resurrected, a nativist, xenophobic, racist rhetoric at the very beginning of his campaign, calling African countries shithole countries, the Muslim ban, targeting immigrants from Latin America. He's resurrected so much of this. Now he's leading, continuing to lead the great lie that the election was stolen, which led to an attack on the Capitol, the first since the War of 1812, an attack by white nationalists who harbor beliefs of the Great Replacement Theory, and now we have it manifesting in Buffalo and different places all over the world. So this is where we are, and that is why we have to respond by condemning it unequivocally and then pushing it as a movement to condemn it across the country. Thank you all so much. Thank you so much for coming. Thank you. And shout out to Faye Rabin. She wrote the resolution.